Well, with your host, Carolyn Haley, heard weekly on KKNO Radio, 750 AM, Tuesdays and Thursdays at 9 o'clock AM, to help you turn the page and open a new chapter with the weekly broadcast, special guest, discussions on healthy eating, sleep disorders, over and underweight management, exercise, fitness, community resources, and more for a healthier and happy you. Tune in each week on KKNO 750 AM, Tuesdays and Thursdays, 9 o'clock AM, for I'm Living Well. It's time.
Good morning, and good morning, and welcome to the I'm Living Well radio broadcast, heard right here on K75 AM each Tuesday and Thursday morning at 9 AM. I guess you've heard the excitement in my voice by now over the last few weeks. We're also on K107.1 FM. Yes, you heard it right. We are on AM and FM. You can also live stream us at KKNO750AM.com. Heard all around the world. Yes, YouTube, live stream, AM, FM, and it goes on and on. Yes, God is in the blessing business, opening up doors, doors for his people to hear, doors for believers as well as unbelievers to hear. So yes, we are so grateful. I'm Carolyn Haley, your host for this program. Each and every week, I promise you that we are going to have a special guest. Well, no need to think that I've disappointed you by now. Today, we have Apostle Kevin Adams with us. Good morning, Apostle.
Good evening. How you doing?
I am doing absolutely great, and I am so elated that you have joined me on today.
Yes, yes. Glad to be here.
Great, great. All right, Apostle Adams, tell us about yourself.
I've been preaching since I was 8 years old, did my first public sermon, and I've been pastoring for 15 years, married. I have two sons. I love working out. I love watching movies. I love studying the Word of God, and I love God's people, and I love empowering God's people, helping them to grow in God's grace.
Awesome. That is such a wonderful thing as an apostle and as a pastor to love the people of God and to want to see the people of God grow. And we just are so grateful for that. Well, today we're going to be talking, as I said before, if you heard me on last broadcast, we're talking for the next few weeks about a healthy mind. Yes, a healthy mind. What would it profit us to have a healthy body and not have a healthy mind? Or a healthy mind and not have a healthy body? So here on the I'm Living Well broadcast, we are interested in body, soul, and spirit. That's our interest because that's God's interest. God is interested in every aspect, every little detail of my life. Even the things I'm not interested in, he's interested in. So we are so grateful for that. So Apostle Adams is going to be talking with us today about developing a healthy soul. Developing a healthy soul. My God, what a wonderful topic. Apostle Adams, what in the world is a healthy soul?
Well, when I think about the soul, from a biblical perspective, the soul consists of the mind, the will, the emotions, the imagination, the volition. It is the seat of the personality and the desires. The soul is the part that didn't get saved when we were born again. The spirit is the part that got saved, the part that has God consciousness, the part that is holy, it is righteous, but the soul has to be trained. And so a lot of times we've heard about the spirit and we've been trained on the spirit, but we haven't heard much about the soul. And what we're going to learn is that Jesus has provided us everything through his death, burial, resurrection, and ascension, his seating. But it is up to us to renew our minds to, I want to say, the Bible says we have the mind of Christ, the book of 1 Corinthians chapter number 2. We have the mind of Christ, but what's going to happen is we're going to have to learn how to let this mind be. And so We really can't have a healthy soul until we discern God's thoughts, until we understand, until we comprehend, until we know his thoughts. He says in the book of Isaiah, my ways are not your ways. My thoughts are not your thoughts. My thoughts are higher than your thoughts. My ways are higher than your ways. So as being born again, our job now is to be renewed in the spirit of our mind. And so we have to learn Jesus, and we have to learn who he is. We have to learn our new nature. And when we learn our new nature, we learn to think like him, we're developing that healthy soul. And what happens is our soul is connected to our emotions. Our soul, your mind is connected to how you feel. And so if this mind is not renewed, then you're a believer. You possess the power of God. You're righteous. You're holy. But you can never walk it out.
Wow.
And other people will never be able to see that. And then you start spewing out unhealthy emotions. You start spewing out, people get to witness depression, and they get to witness oppression, and witness the root of bitterness and anger. And so all of these things are connected to our soul. Your spirit is holy. Your spirit is right. Your spirit is pure. You have power in your spirit. You don't have a deficiency in your spirit. Mm-hmm. You don't have a weak spirit. But our soul, the scripture all throughout the book of Psalms and other places speak of the soul. Yes. And so the soul is the part that feels oppression. The soul is the part. The Bible says, abstain from fleshly lust, which war against our soul. Mm-hmm. See, what the enemy knows, that he can't defeat you. If he can get you to walk in your feelings, mm-hmm. if he can get you to believe what you feel and to say what you feel, then he can begin to capitalize. Now you give him an open door, open space.
Wow.
So when we don't discern God's thoughts, when we don't think according to the word of God, we cannot have a healthy soul. But when we think in alignment with God's word, now we're developing a healthy soul. And when you develop a healthy soul, it extends to every area of your life.
Wow.
Your finances, your relationships, it extends to every area. Beloved, I would wish above all that you prosper and be in health, even as your soul. That word there, the soul, means your psyche,
mm-hmm.
your psyche, the way you think.
Mm-hmm.
And so we're not under any generational curse, but we do have some soulish patterns, some things that are associated with our former way of living that must be renewed, that must be worked out and walked out.
Hallelujah. My Lord. That gave us a lot of information, y'all. A lot of information. So listen, when he talked about what is a healthy soul, we have a better understanding now. The soul, the mind, the will, the emotions, the volition is the seed of our personality, the part that feels. So we've talked a little bit about those feelings. So today we're going to get into a little bit deeper about, you know, what part do they really play? But I want you to hold up for that part, okay? So we want to look a little bit closer, and he's told us this, but I want him to elaborate a little bit more, because we hear these terms many times used interchangeably and many times used out of context. So we have to, as we've said before, so many times we have to use terms in the context of the scripture in which we see them. So what I'd like for Apostle Adams to do is to just basically, from some of the scriptures actually that he's just mentioned, was tell like soul, mind, heart, spirit. You've already told us that the spirit is that perfect part of us.
Mm-hmm.
That's a God thing. That's God. So we don't need to be trying to work on that. You know, I know we hear a lot of people say, you need to get your spirit right.
Mm-hmm.
But it's really not that we need to be working on.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Mm-hmm. Spirit is sometimes also in the word of God is defined as morale or an attitude. Okay, so sometimes when the Bible talks about in 1 Corinthians, the spirit of the world is talking about renouncing the attitude that's associated with that system. Sometimes the scripture, like you said, uses the words interchangeably. Like you might see the word soul, and like in the book of Acts, it talks about in 3,500 souls were saved, which speaks of individuals. And then you might see it in another term where you might see soul. soul. You might find it in the book of Psalms. You might be dealing with the heart of man, okay? And then you might find in 3 John, the soul, which is dealing with the mind, okay? And so depending on the text, depending on the scripture, we got to find out the exact meaning and what it's actually referring to. One of these scriptures in Matthew 22:37 speaks of loving the Lord God with all our heart, our mind, and all our soul. Another translation says with all of your energy and your emotions. Now, in that scripture in the book of Matthew, chapter number 22, Jesus is talking about the law. He's talking about the law, and you know, people are asking him questions, trying to trip him up. And he said, these are the greatest commandments, that you love the Lord thy God first. Then he said, you know, love thy neighbor as thyself. And so that first one about us loving the Lord with all our heart, all our mind, all our soul. Remember, now we under the law. So remember that under the law, it we actually can't perform these things on our own. It's actually there to actually trip us up, make us know that we were in need of a Savior. Jesus fulfilled Matthew 22:37, and that he was able to love the Lord with all of his mind, all of his heart, and all of his soul. And now, so under the new covenant now, our focus now, the Bible said the love of God has been shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost. We love him because he first loved us. So by Jesus fulfilling that scripture now, our job as new covenant believers is not so much our focus on how much we love God, but it's focusing on God's love for us. He says in the book of Ephesians, I want you to comprehend. I want you to understand the knowledge, the scripture says the height, breadth, the depth, the width. It says your job is to seek to understand God's love for you. Mm-hmm. And so when we understand God's love for us, now we can begin to respond. We can love him back, and then we can love our neighbors. We can love our brothers, and so we can fulfill the love law, as the scripture says. 1 Thessalonians 5:23 says that God wants to sanctify us completely or holy. That word, that holy there, is dealing with, as denoting a total work, is dealing with the spirit, the soul, and the body. Okay? Your spirit was made new when you became born again. That was done by Jesus. That was done by the power of the Holy Spirit. You have new DNA. But now, you're responsible. We don't understand it sometimes as believers. We pray prayers like, Lord, will you please help my mind and this, that, and other. And what you don't understand is that you have been given the power. You have all the power that you need. Now he's telling you, he said, think on these things. Mm-hmm. And so what happens is we so much can't control what comes into our mind, but we can control what we meditate on. We can control. And so it's called a mindset. And so we're going to have to train our souls. That's the thing. It's about the training, the development of our souls. The scripture said to work out your salvation. The part that he was referring to is talking about your mind, your will, your emotions, your volition. And so as believers, we have a choice in the matter. It's not so much what God is going to do. He's already finished the work. Amen. Now you have to choose what he has chosen for you. He has chosen that your thoughts line up with his thoughts. That's why he tells you in the book of Philippians, he says, think on these things. Whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are of a good report. He says, think on these things. So he's actually given us the template, the blueprint on how to develop a healthy soul by thinking or meditating, fixing our thoughts, setting our affections on these things. And so without the believer applying that, if we don't apply, set your affections on these things, if we don't apply, be ye renewed in the spirit of your mind, you have all the power. You have all the purpose. You have all the anointing, but it's never manifested in your life. It's never done through you or in you. Why? Because you've left out the soul. You've left out your thought life. Matter of fact, you can't be spiritual we talk about being spiritual, and we oftentimes connect that to alone, you know, dancing, shouting, being in church. But being spiritual is much more than being in church. It's much more than dancing. It's much more than shouting. Those things are a part of it, but it's about having them. It's about you letting this mind, letting your thoughts line up with the will and the purpose of God, that you might prove. See, you can't prove it. You can't prove the will of God. You can't prove his good and acceptable and perfect will until that transformation takes place in the soul, in the mind, until you make a decision to choose. See, the believer has to understand you have the power to choose. The Satan has been defeated. I know we harbor on Satan and the devil and we harbor on Jezebel and witchcraft. All of those things are real. But what Jesus did for us through the shedding of his blood, the Bible says he nailed these things to the cross. And then the Bible says he spoiled principalities and powers. Our focus under the new covenant is to be on what Jesus has done for us, the authority that he has given unto us, how he has stripped Satan of his power. The deficiency is in the knowledge of God. If you don't have truth in a certain area, then you have ignorance. He said, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. So when you don't have the knowledge of God in a certain area, then you're incapable of manifesting his will and his purpose in that area, whether it's relationally, whether it's financially, whether it's in your body, whether it's keeping your thoughts together. Whatever it is, when you're ignorant in a certain area, you will not be able to walk out that area. You will not have progress. Okay, you will not have prosperity in that area. So it's when we get God's thoughts, when we get his words, when we understand what God thinks about finances, what the Bible says, our bodies are fearfully and wonderfully made. When we see how God has made our bodies, then we will begin to, we understand we are already healed.
Amen.
Now if you don't start thinking like you're healed, if you're healed, you possess it in your spirit, but if you don't start thinking like you, if you think that you're sick, if you think that you're depressed, if you meditate on these things, then your body is simply going to respond. And so your spirit is a king, your soul is a servant, and your body is a slave.
Wow.
And so your soul needs a master. You're either going to subject, either we're going to be led by the Spirit, and that's the purpose of the Holy Spirit, to have dictatorship, to rule over the soul, to govern. We're human beings. We understand that we have emotions. We understand that we have feelings. But we need the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit tells us, hey, hold on. Wait a minute. I know what you feel.
Yes.
But the Holy Spirit reminds us of who we are.
Yes.
And so he always reminds us of who we are. And so when we start allowing the Holy Spirit to tell us, this is who you are, and when we start meditating, this is who you are, eventually you're going to start walking out who you are. You're going to manifest that in every area of your life.
Awesome. Let me tell you, this word is so meaty, I don't even know which part to reiterate on, but I'm going to do my best, because listen, it is so important that we really get this. There are a few points that I just want to reiterate. He talked about the love of God. What shall separate us from the love of God? Aren't you happy that it's not your love? And because it's not your love, because it's his love, because it's him that's loving us and keeping us, nothing can separate us from it. Let this mind. Now, I really want you to dwell on that. Let this mind. Apostle Adams have talked about the power being in your hands, the ball being in your court. Let this mind. The word let means either you can let or let not. It gives you the implication that there is the power for you to choose. And that's what he talked about. I love this. And man, I got to put a star here by. It's easy. It's easy to choose, because guess what? He says, choose what has been chosen for you. Hey, if it's already been chosen for me, then my job becomes the last part of what he talked about, the deficiency in the knowledge. Let me find out what has been chosen for me. And then he talked about the manifestation of the will and how it's going to be manifested. We have the power to make these choices. The soul is the servant. Let's remember that. The Bible clearly tells you that the members, our members, they are servant to the Spirit of God that has been born again on the inside of us. What do we meditate on? I love this part. He says, maybe you can't choose what comes in, but hey, I bet you can choose what stays there. I bet you can choose what you're going to think on. It goes back to the, I don't have to think about it again. What do we think on? He's already told us. Those things that are lovely, those things that appear, those things that have a good report. He's already laid it out for us. Apostle Adam said, everything that's going to be done, it's already been done. So now you and I, my dear brother, my dear sister, our job becomes finding out what it is, digging into the word, getting into the scripture, not just going on Bible class night, not just going on Sunday morning or Sunday evening, but having that personal relationship with the Holy Spirit that as we read the word of God, he unveils it. He shows it to us. He makes it alive on the inside of us. And then when that word starts getting on the inside of us, we really will have a testimony. We'll be able to walk it out. We'll be able to do that. Now, Apostle Adams, you've already shared with us some of the steps that are necessary in training or developing a healthy soul. And I just want you to elaborate a little bit more on that, but also you basically said to us that God is not responsible for your mind. You are. Mm-hmm. I am. Mm-hmm. I'm responsible for my mind.
Mm-hmm. All about five scriptures in the New Covenant, Romans 12, 1 through 3, the ones that I named, I think it was Philippians chapter number 2, Colossians chapter number 3, set your affection on things above, 3 John. I mean, constantly, all throughout Ephesians 4, 23, all throughout the scripture, he's letting us know, listen, you're no longer a slave. See, people who are under the law, they're trying to do things in their own strength. See, under the law, you're really a slave to the sin that is in your members. But what the grace of God has done for us, it is that it has set us free. It has given us the ability to make the choice. The Bible said, now sin shall have no dominion over you. Why? Because you are not under the law, you are under grace. And so grace gives us the power. It gives us the power to choose. Now we can obey God. As the Bible said, as you have obeyed that form of doctrine, you've been set free. You once were the servants of sin, but now you are the servants of righteousness. Now you really can live a holy life now. You couldn't do it before under your own strength. The law brought you to a place where it pointed out the sin. It showed you how wrong you were, but it did not give you the power to stop the wrong. The law says you shouldn't do this. The law says you shouldn't drink. The law says you shouldn't commit. The law says this, but the sin, the problem is not the law. The law is holy. The problem is your members. The problem is I know it's wrong for me to do it, but I can't stop doing it. So grace has given us the power now. Now we are free, glory to God, free from the prison of sin. And so now the believer has to hear this to know this. Because if we're not taught this, then we're going to continuously believe you're under the curse. No. The Bible said for the believers, Jesus has redeemed us from the curse of the law. For those who are listening out there, you're a believer. You are not under a generational curse. There is no trace of iniquity. Glory to God. Hallelujah. The Bible says you have been set free. The Bible says he remembers none of your sins. He doesn't remember. So if you're bringing things, see, this all has to do with the soul. Because what happens is what the blood of Jesus has done is has purged our conscience from dead works. And so if you're not taught this, if you're not trained this as the believer, then the first thing you do, the enemy is beating you up with condemnation. The enemy is beating you up with guilt. He starts beating you up with fear. And if he can use fear and see, glory to God. See, under the old covenant, there was something called the Day of Atonement, or at one with God. God never wanted to be separated from his people. When God says, Adam, where art thou? That's not God's angry voice in the garden. Adam is in relationship, in perfect union with God, and that fellowship is broken. At that moment, the death sentence, when I say death, I'm not talking about you living 90 years and then dying. I'm not talking about physical death. I'm speaking of separation. And so what happens is, when we got saved, sin was separated from us and we became connected to God. And so by being connected to God, now we have power over sin. We have power over it now. Therefore, now he tells us, count or reckon yourselves dead unto sin, meaning that sin is separated from you. You died into it. It's been separated from you. It's been removed from you. But he says, count yourself as alive unto God. So I'm only responding to God. So even though I'm saved, these thoughts have a tendency to come in my mind. And what happens is the enemy can shoot out. The Bible says the fiery darts. So he throws his little fiery darts. He throws his little fiery jabs. And what happens is if he can get you to believe what he is trying to condemn you of, if he can get you to believe what you feel, if he can get you to believe that you're not forgiven, if he can get you to believe that you're going to die just like your mama died young, if he can get you to believe these things, whatever you start believing, you're going to start speaking out of your mouth. And eventually, you're going to have whatever you say. Where is this occurring? These things are occurring in the thought life. These things are occurring in the soul. And so if he can get you to shoot it, if he can shoot his fiery darts, if he can get you to meditate on these things long enough, then what's going to happen is what you're going to do? You're going to yield your volition. You're going to yield your will. Okay, yep, this I'm going to be. I'm going to be like this for the rest of my life. Yep. Sorry. I'm just a chip off the old block. Yep, this is one. And God has so much more for you. You've been redeemed. You are more than a conqueror. Not just you. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. But if you don't believe it, if you don't train yourself to think that way, if you don't train your... See, you have to become aware or conscious of what Jesus has done. He's already done it. But if you're not aware of it, if you're not conscious of it, if you're more conscious of demons, devils, anxiety, fear, if you're more aware of that, then those things are going to dominate your life. For so a man thinketh, so is he. If you think that way, if that's what you think on, if you're meditating on it, if you're not letting the word of God wash you, then yes, you're a believer, you have the victory, but you're not going to walk out that victory. And so you have the power to choose. You're no longer a slave. You have the power to choose. Jesus has reconciled us, connected us back to the Father. You have power to choose. You have authority as a son, and you need to know it, and you need to start thinking like it, and then it's going to start manifesting in every area of your life.
My God. My dear listener, we're not out of word, as Pastor Sam would say, but we are out of time. But I want you to know, and before Apostle Adams leaves us, he's going to give us the information about the Instagram and all of these other things, how you can follow him, and the name and location of his two locations, actually, that he's in. This is such a rich word. Play it again. Apostle Adams, tell them how they can follow you on the media outlets and where your locations are.
You guys can follow me, Apostle Kevin Adams Jr., on Facebook. We have service at 9 o'clock in Slidell. I'm trying to always get my address.
That's okay. They can look Slidell, it up on Facebook.
But we're a Kingdom Life. And we're in Slidell, Louisiana at 9 o'clock on Sundays. And then we're here at Destrehan, River Road, Highway 48 at 12 o'clock after that. Kingdom Life. Worship Center. Okay, and you can pull it up. You find it on Facebook. You can find it on Google. And and we're looking forward to helping the people of God out. Amen. We believe that God has given us a word that is going to be a blessing, spirit, soul, and body.
Amen. Thank you so much. Join me again next time, will you, right here. I'm Living Well radio broadcast every Tuesday and Thursday morning, K750 AM and K107.1 FM. God bless you.
Are you ready to turn the page and close the chapter on poor health or lack of wellness? No need to fear. We have just the radio program for you. It's I'm Living Well with your host, Carolyn Haley, heard weekly on KKNO Radio, 750 AM, Tuesdays and Thursdays at 9 o'clock AM to help you turn the page and open a new chapter with the weekly broadcast, special guests, discussions on healthy eating, sleep disorders, over and underweight management, exercise, fitness, community resources, and more for a healthier and happy you. Tune in each week on KKNO 750 AM, Tuesdays and Thursdays, 9 o'clock AM, for I'm Living Well. It's time.
K75 AM and K107.1 FM.